Welcome to Health Matters. On today's show, we'll discuss the latest technology in hearing aids with Dr. Katie Sullivan. And later, my wife and guest co-host, Rena Santora, joins the show and we'll discuss the ingredients, both good and bad, in coffee creamers. But first, I'd like to welcome Brea City Fire Department Battalion Chief Adrian Montoya to discuss what you can expect when you call 911 in an emergency. Adrian, thanks for coming.
It's my pleasure. Thanks for inviting me.
You know, this is very interesting. You and I are both parents of Chapman students. Your son just graduated. My daughter's been here for almost 3 years, and we've been delighted with Chapman. And your career and mine have paralleled each other. When we started early on 30 years ago, and you were a firefighter, and then you were an engineer, the guy who drives the truck.
Correct.
And then you were a captain, and now you're a battalion chief at, at Brea. And you've also been a paramedic, and I know you've been instrumental in paramedic inception, almost at the beginning of this in Orange County. And that's how you knew my wife, Rena. She was a radio nurse way back when.
Since 1980.
And people really like to know. They adore firemen. Firemen are up here, and doctors are way down here. But anyway, everybody adores firemen, but they're also afraid of them in an emergency. What happens during 911? When should they call 911? And what really goes on during that process? Can you tell us?
Yeah. When a patient calls 911, they usually have a medical emergency, a fire emergency, or some type of environmental emergency. And that's when the fire service responds. When a person will call 911, they'll get a call taker. And that call taker will differentiate between a police type of call or a fire-related call. And they'll transfer that call to that correct dispatch center. So when they call us, we'll respond out in our fire equipment. And what we'll do is we'll show up with our EMTs, or emergency medical technicians. All of the firefighters in Orange County are emergency medical technicians. Okay. And there are some specialized paramedic units as well.
And this always confused me. So you're always going to have like a fire truck and a paramedic unit, is that right?
That's correct.
No matter what the medical emergency is.
Right. And the way that that came about is that our stations are spaced apart in such a way that we respond within about 4 to 6 minutes. And 4 to 6 minutes is a valuable valuable time for us to intervene, especially when there's a biological death about to set in.
What could a family do? They call 911, what should they do to make it better for you to, you know, make the process go smoother? I mean, you're not gonna come in and knock the doors down, and do you always come with light flashing? And, you know, I know there's a lot of fear. Do they have to have some preparation for you to make it work better?
Well, it sounds real basic, but here's some things that we've run across. Locked doors or access that we can't get through. If a person, after they call 911, if they can have their front door open, the lights on at night, and if they live in an apartment complex, if they have someone to wave us down out in the street, that sure helps us out quite a bit. Yeah. And the other thing for us, too, is that once we arrive, we would like, it would be great if we had a list of medications, allergies, maybe a list of the doctors that they see, any recent treatments, and any other paperwork such as advance directives or any other paperwork that could help us interpret why we're there in the first place.
You know, another question that patients always ask is, they're not taking me to the hospital of my choice. They always want to go where your doctor is or your doctor's associated. Now, we have like 23 hospitals or so in Orange County. So how do you explain that? I know it's done in the patient's best interest, but what's the thinking behind taking them where you guys want to take them?
Well, usually when we hear that a patient asking if they can be taken to a certain facility, their reasons are usually because their doctor, either their doctor works there or their insurance is carried through that hospital. But the things that we take into considerations are they stable enough to bypass that closest hospital to make it to their to the hospital of their choice? Another reason is that receiving facility that they want to go to appropriate for the problem that we're seeing? In other words, are they having a heart attack? Did they have a fall, having some internal injuries? And another reason, which is pretty basic for us, and we run across it every once in a while, is the hospital that they want to be taken to, are their beds completely full? Or can we afford to take that patient to that hospital and have beds open for them?
Now, years ago, when you started your training, they started trauma hospitals. And so I imagine that was the beginning of these selective centers or receiving centers with certain things, and I know you're instrumental in a lot of that. So now we have other receiving centers, right?
That's correct. We have trauma centers in Orange County. We also have cardiovascular receiving centers, and that's just been within the last few years that that the level of care from the time that we come show up to that person's house, recognize a need for cardiac intervention, and have them delivered to the correct hospital. Our goal is to shorten that time, and with the advent of these cardiovascular receiving centers, the patient outcome is generally better.
Yeah, and as you know, I'm an interventional cardiologist, so we have this, we work very more closely with you guys than ever, because once you tell us that there's a heart attack coming in, a certain type of heart attack on the EKG, we get the ball rolling. So by the time that patient gets to the door and into the cath lab, we open that artery up within 90 minutes. It's called door to balloon time, as you well know. And we couldn't do that without all the training that you guys have. So it's been an amazing process. We're saving more and more lives. The technology is getting more sophisticated. And we're going to spend a minute going to your facility out in Brea and see what it really happens in real life.
Good. Great. When a citizen calls 911, that phone call gets routed to the appropriate dispatch center. That dispatch center decides the type of call it is and then sends the appropriate resources to that call. Our first priority when you arrive to a call is just to stabilize the scene as well as stabilize the patient. It could be a freeway call, it could be a hazardous situation. When paramedics arrive, the first thing that they need to check is to see if they have a stable patient. And we have a system, a list of questions, our own way of determining the level of care that that patient is going to require. We don't know what type of call we're going to be going on, so we carry a number of different things on our fire engine.
Here at the Brea Fire Department, on a paramedic engine, we have several pieces of equipment that we carry in for all our basic medical calls, whether it's something that would be life-threatening or to a simple call as a cut finger. Our first piece of equipment here is our LifePak 12, basically our heart monitor, and this is where we can look at your heart in a bunch of different angles, and it will tell us different clues to look for in terms of what is exactly going wrong with you. And we'll get a printout down here on the bottom. That'll give us information and give us rhythms off your heart, exactly what's going on. If you're having a heart attack or something of that nature, every paramedic unit will carry in a medical drug box. Within our drug box, we're going to carry all sorts of the different medications that we have up here in the top that we can give you either by a direct shot into your arm or your leg, or we can actually start an IV out in the field. And with that, we can give medications through the IVs. Little diagnosing equipment in here for diabetics. We can actually check your blood sugar right out in the field. And if somebody has a low blood sugar, we can actually give them some medications to raise their sugar levels back up. In our back row, we carry all our needles, just like you would have at a normal medical facility, to start our IVs and give shots. This is a basic oxygen cylinder. And with our side pouch, we'll carry different size masks to either place on a person's face or to give them through their nose, what we call a nasal cannula. For people that are having difficulty breathing or people that are in a full arrest, we will actually intubate a patient. And that means basically we'll put a tube down their throat. Up here I'll have my different sizes of intubation tubes that I can pull out for a patient. And then up in the top here, a paramedic can pull out his equipment, and we call this the laryngeal blades. It will actually give us a light so we can see down your throat as we're looking in. The most common what people see out in the field that they're really familiar with is what we call a BVM or bag mouth valves. And this is what you always see on the medical shows or ER or something. That field is when they're actually breathing for a patient. This is one of our portable suction units that we can use out in the field to actually remove any fluids orally that somebody might have in their mouth. You can hear the suction, it'll actually pull up fluids out of their mouth. In our bags, we have what we call airway adjuncts. They're basically little tubes that we can stick in your nose, or we stick little mouthpieces like a bite guard in your mouth. And this basically prevents the tongue from closing off the airway in the initial phases when we're breathing for you before we actually get a tube down your throat. This will help keep your airway open for us. This is a needle thoracostomy kit, and basically this allows me to put a needle in your chest when you have pressure buildup in your chest. You've lost the vacuum, typically from a stabbing or something. We'll actually stick a needle in your chest, and this will allow pressure to escape to reestablish the balance of air in your chest. One of our last pieces of equipment that we carry in our paramedic unit is our basic BLS bag. We just carry a bunch of different band-aids and equipment in here that will help us. This is what we call a C-collar. We put these around people's necks. Very common in a traffic accident, somebody's injured their neck, has a little bit of whiplash, playing neck pain. We'll come in and place this around your neck. It holds your head straight, and then we'll place you into one of our backboards before we transport you to the hospital. We carry everything from your basic tape to just giant wraps of cling that we can use to secure items. And then the side, we do carry our basic medical equipment of a blood pressure cuff and a stethoscope for taking blood pressure out in the field. And then most commonly what people ask for when you're out in the field, carry right here in this bag. And that is simply for, do you have a Band-Aid? And we carry Band-Aids too.
When we get called, time is usually a real critical factor. So we need information like where to respond to, which building, which apartment. The more information that citizens can give to our dispatch center, that our dispatch centers can provide to us, the quicker we can respond to those patients who are in need of our care.
Adrian, that was great. We've run out of time, unfortunately, but it was a great topic. I think we need to get together again and discuss some other, I know there's so much that you're doing. Thanks so much for coming, saving lives.
My pleasure.
Thanks
for
inviting me. Nice to work together with you. We'll be right back.
Fact or fiction? It is best to starve a fever and feed a cold.
Fiction. It will not help to lower your fever if you don't eat. Actually, severely limiting your food intake while you are sick, whether it's from a fever or a cold, hinders the healing process. Don't force yourself if you don't feel well enough to eat as much as you normally do, but at least drink plenty of fluids.
Fortunately for those of us from the rock and roll era, hearing aids have drastically improved both in function and appearance over the last several years. Our next guest, Dr. Katie Sullivan, is an audiologist, and she specializes in the needs of the hearing impaired children and adults at the Providence Speech and Hearing Center right here in the city of Orange. Thanks for coming, Katie.
Thank you for having me.
You know, in my practice, I have maybe 20% of the patients have hearing aids, and I would say 90% of them are unhappy with them. And I guess maybe you can enlighten us, maybe they're not getting fitted properly or getting them done at the right place. But I really wonder, is hearing loss really increasing in the population now? Are boomers really at risk?
Absolutely, yes. Noise-induced hearing loss from all the rock and roll music that they heard without hearing protection. It's one of the biggest reasons for adults with hearing loss. So there is an increase as we get older. We're living longer. We do have hearing loss. And then the noise that we used to hear, it's all adding up.
So we can expect our kids who have been exposed to even higher decibels and listen to more music and have iPods, this and that, you think there's going to be even a worse problem?
Yes. In fact, just last week I had a second grader with noise-induced hearing loss.
Wow.
Wore the iPods way too loud in his ears.
Is that right?
Mm-hmm.
Second grade.
Yes. So now, we have to really be careful, protect our hearing.
Yeah, I think a lot of people don't realize that. I mean everybody has iPods, and it's even just growing more and more. What about medications? Are there any specific medications that people should worry about?
Yes. Any type of medication should definitely be talked about with their physician. Something as simple as aspirin, and too much aspirin could cause a side effect of hearing loss called tinnitus, and it's just very dangerous to take too much aspirin. Other medications, very strong antibiotics, even chemotherapy, it all affects the hearing.
Now explain, what is tinnitus?
Tinnitus is a ringing or buzzing noise in your ears, and sometimes it goes right hand in hand with hearing loss. Sometimes it's the very first sign that you may have a hearing impairment. So if you have tinnitus or the ringing or buzzing noises, then you should talk to your physician about it and actually get your hearing tested.
So that would be a signal that this is possibly a warning sign. Say if you have no symptoms, when do you think an adult should start getting tested for their hearing?
You know, that's a good question. I think if you can't remember your last hearing test, or maybe even back in high school, it's probably time to get your hearing tested, simply as a baseline for future tests, so you can compare. If you have any symptoms of your ears ringing or buzzing, then you want to get your hearing tested too. We test hearing of all ages, so it's never too young to get your hearing tested.
What about the, is there any evidence that if you, say you're starting to have hearing loss, and then you start to hear, use a hearing aid, does it slow the hearing loss process in some, by any measure?
No, that's a good
Welcome to Health Matters. On today's show, we'll discuss the latest technology in hearing aids with Dr. Katie Sullivan. And later, my wife and guest co-host, Rena Santora, joins the show and we'll discuss the ingredients, both good and bad, in coffee creamers. But first, I'd like to welcome Brea City Fire Department Battalion Chief Adrian Montoya to discuss what you can expect when you call 911 in an emergency. Adrian, thanks for coming.
It's my pleasure. Thanks for inviting me.
You know, this is very interesting. You and I are both parents of Chapman students. Your son just graduated. My daughter's been here for almost 3 years, and we've been delighted with Chapman. And your career and mine have paralleled each other. When we started early on 30 years ago, and you were a firefighter, and then you were an engineer, the guy who drives the truck.
Correct.
And then you were a captain, and now you're a battalion chief at, at Brea. And you've also been a paramedic, and I know you've been instrumental in paramedic inception, almost the beginning of this in Orange County. And my and that's how you knew my wife, Rena. She was a radio nurse way back when.
Since 1980. Mm-hmm.
And people really like to know. They adore firemen. Firemen are up here, and doctors are way down here. But anyway, everybody adores firemen, but they're also afraid of them in an emergency. Mm-hmm. What happens during 911? When should they call 911? And what really goes on during that process? Can you tell us?
Yeah. When a patient calls 911, they usually have a medical emergency, a fire emergency, or some type of environmental emergency. Mm-hmm. And that's when the fire service responds. When a person will call 911, they'll get a call taker. And that call taker will differentiate between a police type of call or a fire-related call. And they'll transfer that call to that correct dispatch center. So when they call us, we'll respond out in our fire equipment. And what we'll do is we'll show up with our EMTs or emergency medical technicians. All of the firefighters in Orange County are emergency medical technicians. Okay. And there are some specialized paramedic units as well.
And this always confused me. So you're always going to have like a fire truck and a paramedic unit, is that right?
That's correct.
No matter what the medical emergency is.
Right. And the way that that came about is that our stations are spaced apart in such a way that we respond within about 4 to 6 minutes. Mm-hmm. And 4 to 6 minutes is a valuable time for us to intervene, especially when there's a biological death about to set in.
What could a family do? They call 911. What should they do to make it better for you to, you know, make the process go smoother? I mean, you're not going to come in and knock the doors down. And do you always come with light flashing? And, you know, I know there's a lot of fear. Do they have to have some preparation for you to make it work better?
Well, it sounds real basic, but here's some things that we've run across. Locked doors or access that we can't get through. If a person, after they call 911, if they can have their front door open, the lights on at night, and if they live in an apartment complex, if they have someone to wave us down out in the street, that sure helps us out quite a bit. Yeah. And the other thing for us, too, is that once we arrive, it would be great if we had a list of medications, allergies, maybe a list of the doctors that they see, any recent treatments, and any other paperwork, such as advance directives or any other paperwork that could help us interpret why we're there in the first place.
You know, another question that patients always ask is, they're not taking me to the hospital of my choice. They always want to go where your doctor is or your doctor's associated. Now, we have like 23 hospitals or so in Orange County. So how do you explain that? I know it's done in the patient's best interest, but what's the thinking behind taking them where you guys want to take them?
Well, usually when we hear that a patient asking if they can be taken to a certain facility, their reasons are usually because their doctor works there or their insurance is carried through that hospital. Mm-hmm. But the things that we take into consideration are they stable enough to bypass that closest hospital to make it to the hospital of their choice? Mm-hmm. Another reason is that receiving facility that they want to go to appropriate for the problem that we're seeing? In other words, are they having a heart attack? Did they have a fall, having some internal injuries? And another reason, which is pretty basic for us, and we run across it every once in a while, is the hospital that they want to be taken to, are their beds completely full? Can we afford to take that patient to that hospital and have beds open for them?
Now, years ago, when you started your training, they started trauma hospitals. And so I imagine that was the beginning of these selective centers or receiving centers with certain things. And I know you're instrumental in a lot of that. So now we have other receiving centers, right?
That's correct. We have trauma centers in Orange County. We also have cardiovascular receiving centers. And that's just been within the last few years that that the level of care from the time that we come show up to that person's house, recognize a need for cardiac intervention, and have them delivered to the correct mm-hmm. hospital, our goal is to shorten that time. And with the advent of these cardiovascular receiving centers, the patient outcome is generally better.
Yeah, and as you know, I'm an interventional cardiologist, so we have this, we work very more closely with you guys than ever, because once you tell us that there's a heart attack coming in, a certain type of heart attack on the EKG, we get the ball rolling. So by the time that patient gets to the door and into the cath lab, we open that artery up within 90 minutes. It's called door to balloon time, as you well know. And we couldn't do that without all the training that you guys have. So it's been an amazing process. We're saving more and more lives. The technology is getting more sophisticated. And we're going to spend a minute going to your facility out in Brea and see what it really happens in real life.
Good. Great. When a citizen calls 911, that phone call gets routed to the appropriate dispatch center. That dispatch center decides the type of call it is and then sends the appropriate resources to that call. Our first priority when you arrive to a call is just to stabilize the scene as well as stabilize the patient. It could be a freeway call, it could be a hazardous situation. When paramedics arrive, the first thing that they need to check is to see if they have a stable patient. And we have a system, a list of questions, our own way of determining the level of care that that patient is going to require. We don't know what type of call we're going to be going on, so we carry a number of different things on our fire engine.
Here at the Brea Fire Department, on a paramedic engine, we have several pieces of equipment that we carry in for all our basic medical calls, whether it's something that would be life-threatening or to a simple call as a cut finger. Our first piece of equipment here is our